a month of purpose. Because purpose can avert judgment in your life. When you're living a life of purpose, when you understand what God is doing, when you understand why God is saying what He's saying, when you understand what you're supposed to do, you will find out that you will excel. And my prayer is that as we discover purpose and meaning, that our lives will change for the better in Jesus' name. Life will be meaningless without purpose. Everything in life has a purpose. There should be purpose for it. One of the first things the enemy does to any person, what Satan does, is to destroy purpose. The people that commit suicide will reach to the point where they say, there is no reason to live again. The devil tried, anybody you see committing suicide, attempted suicide, has reached that point in his life. When they say, it doesn't make sense again to commit, to live on. Last year, early this year, we saw a Welshman that was, well by all standards, the manager of the football club in Wales. Such a wonderful career, used to be a footballer. And you would think that everything is going well. 6-7 digit bank account, wife, children, everything. Well, he reached that point, and he said the best thing is to take life. I pray that purpose will not go for your life in the name of Jesus. The devil is good at telling people, you can't make it. Stop it. Give up. There's no reason to continue. Look at the problems surrounding you. You cannot make it. And because of that, people just have had enough. Daniel, I don't want to hear voice again. People just have had enough. And purpose goes. But God is a God of purpose. And God wants us to discover purpose for our day-to-day lives. So that we can, you know, have a meaning. So that we can enjoy life. Daniel, I don't want to hear your voice again. Praise the Lord. Every gadget in your home serves a purpose. Whether it's the heater, or whatever you have. When they don't serve the purpose or when they become dysfunctional, what do you do? You either repair them or you bin them. That's why every house has a bin. The reason why you have a bin is because this thing is not serving any purpose anymore. Check it out. God wants everything in our life, even our very lives. Can you turn our Bibles to Genesis? Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15 as well. And Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. These are three things I want to share on today. But I won't go for maybe next week, I will dwell on them more. Genesis chapter 3, verse 18. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. And Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. I'm going to probably read the first one. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. I'll read that one first. It says, and the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden, to dress it and to keep it. Just stay there. Turn your Bible to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. The Bible says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let man have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl. Daniel. And over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creep upon the earth. Then turn your Bible to Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. It says, and they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and Eve, his wife, hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the tree in the garden. For today, there are three things I want to share with us on purpose. purpose God made man. If you read Genesis chapter 1, it says, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let man do what dominates. You were created to create, to dominate, to rule, to have control, to decide how things happen. What you see happen in the whole of Genesis is God was dominating the environment, the universe. He was saying, let this happen, let that happen, and they were happening. And God said, that I want to make man in my image, in his image, so that man can do the same thing. So that's the first thing. The second thing we see in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15, the Bible says God put man in the garden to keep it and to dress it, which has to do with work, something that will keep you engaged. God wants you to be engaged. Like I said before, people that commit suicide and stuff like that, they stop engaging. People that give up, they stop engaging. God wants you to be doing something. Whether it's to your, you know, your job, your husband, your school, your academics, something, God wants you to be engaged. And the third thing, which I believe is the most important, you see in Genesis chapter 3, verse 8. The Bible says there that, and God came down in the cool, in the garden in the cool of the evening to see Adam. God wants us to have fellowship with him. It's so hard when you meet people and they tell you they can't, they don't understand why a loving God would allow things to happen. People feel that God is a killjoy. Nothing can be so far from the truth. Do you know it was when Adam and Eve had sinned that the Bible said God was still looking for them, searching for them, because there's something about God and man. God wants man to be so close. That's why when people die, they go to heaven. God couldn't stand the fact that he couldn't stay with man he created. That's why Jesus had to die, so that man can immediately, you drop from this earth, you go and stay with him. That's how deep God wants to fellowship with man. The Bible says in John chapter 4 that the Father seeks worshippers. God wants intimate fellowship. Imagine in the evening, God didn't come in the afternoon when it's very hot, you know, your environment. He came in the evening. He wants to spend time with you. God wants you to come to a level where, you know, two of you relate so intimately that he can reveal purposes, plans for your day-to-day life. It's in that elevated level of relationship with God that you can find solutions to the day-to-day life. And I believe that somebody here will walk out today understanding that God is not far, but very close. Like I said, it was when Adam sinned that the Bible told us that God, in other words, God has been coming every other day. So it's not even the sin that will stop God wanting to come to man. And if we understand that fact, it will change our, because most times what happens is our perception of God is often distorted, and then we feel that we can't make it. But today, God will help us in Jesus' name. Some of the purposes for man include, which I'll say, purpose often will have to be discovered. The thing with purpose is, it's not just lying there. We have to make some discovery. Some people live 40, 80 years to discover what life is about. Moses lived till he was 80 years before he knew that the reason why God spared his life at birth and made sure that Pharaoh's daughter was passing through where he hid him was to be the savior, to deliver the children of the Israelites. Purpose has to be discovered. And I pray that from today, God will help you to discover purpose in the name of Jesus. Some people take a whole lifetime to discover purpose. But my prayer is that you will discover purpose quicker, faster, in the name of Jesus. When we take a look back at our lives, when you just look back, particularly people who have been Christian, you know, you can see how your journey has been. Sometimes you discover, oh, this is where I missed it. This is where I should have done this. You start discovering purpose as you reflect back. Like I said, it's something you need to discover. And And there will be discovery today before we leave in the name of Jesus. There is purpose for day-to-day living in our lives. Proverbs chapter 4 verse 18 says, the path of the righteous is like a shining light that shines brighter and brighter unto the perfect day. Proverbs chapter 4 verse 18. Every day should make your purpose clearer. But you know, the Bible says in verse 19 that the path of the wicked gets darker and darker. So you cannot discover purpose. But if you're in Christ Jesus, you should be able to understand life. Things should be getting clearer and clearer to you every single day. Understanding purpose is vital in knowing the move of God in our life. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, God told Samuel to go and anoint somebody, King David. And Samuel came there. And the first son, Eli, came. And Samuel jumped up and said, surely this is the Lord's anointed. And God said, no, I refuse him. I don't see like man. Look at the heart. You look at outside. The second son came. God said, no. The third son came. God said, no. Seven of them passed. And God said, no. And Samuel asked, is there another person? He said, there's still the youngest, but he's keeping sheep. Samuel said, go and call him. We'll not sit down till he comes. When David came, God said, this is the one anointed. Now listen, because we're talking about purpose today. That was the first time two kings were anointed and two of them were alive. Now Saul has been anointed by the same Samuel, and another king has been anointed, two of them at the same time. If you don't discover purpose, this is the time where people make mistakes in life. Because you'll be confused. Why should there be another king? And only few people understand. Maybe it's only Samuel that will have the information that God told him that Saul is rejected and David is alive. I pray that purpose will become clear in our life in the name of Jesus. Or somebody that was a citizen there was looking at, why are there two kings? Who should I follow? What is happening? What's the purpose of anointing a second king when we already have one? And then it will be very difficult to fathom. Again, purpose in our lives helps us to know what God wants us to do. For David, that anointing meant that he's passed the test of, you know, tending shepherds. Now, there's a new reason why God is asking him to go high. Because everything that happens to us as believers, the Bible says all things work together for good to them that love God, to those who are called according to his purpose and plan, happens for a reason. So that anointing that Samuel anointed David that day meant that a new thing is going to start happening in his life. God has decided to move him momentarily from keeping sheep to that of keeping the flock of God. And David understood that very well. Without understanding purpose, people will miss it. That's the mistake Saul made. Saul didn't understand why he was anointed. Did you understand the purpose of that anointing? He felt it was just for, maybe he's the tallest man, or he could do anything he wanted. No. There's a reason for things that happen to us in life. There's a reason why God brings things across our paths in life. So for David, the moment God anointed him, even though he was, the bad theologians tell us he was just about 17 years, he understood clearly. I pray that you will understand the purpose of God for your life in the name of Jesus. Sometimes the thing we love so much, momentarily we have to stop. And that means that purpose has changed. Something has changed. You need to move on. The Bible says the moment David was anointed, if you read 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 13 and 14, verse 14 says, the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. And the Spirit of the Lord rested on David. So how can you know when you're talking about spiritual things, things you can't see? That's why it's good to discover purpose, to know what is happening. And you can only do that when, like I said, in Genesis chapter 3, you spend time with God. When we spend time with God, God reveals things to us. This month, or last year, I had an issue that really troubled me. And I couldn't really sleep. My wife even noticed I was thinking so much. And you know what? I said, I'm not going to do anything till I go for the night vigil. That I know that by the time I pray, I will get something from God. And that was exactly what happened. By the time the night vigil finished, as I was coming back, an idea just dropped into my spirit and said, handle this thing this way. And that body just left. And I know that if I'm going to do it that way, that I'm going to have success. The moment David was anointed, there's a purpose for everything. Something happened. Let's turn our Bible to 1 Samuel so that I won't just be talking. 1 Samuel chapter 16, from verse 13. He says, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Verse 14, but the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him. And Saul's servant said unto him, behold now,